myths and hoaxes have a way of changing the way we think and act about just about anything during our daily living or things that we get involved in. Now, of course, the Vietnam POW M.I.A. situation just might be one of those elaborate hoaxes, and that's what we're going to talk about on today's program. Good morning. I'm Joe Hunter. This is Perspective. My guest is the John Cotton Dana Professor of English and American Studies at Rutgers University, H. Bruce Franklin. And Mr. Franklin is the author of the book M.I.A. or Mythmaking in America, which you see up on the screen. We'll return and talk with our guest, Bruce Franklin, right after this. My guest, H. Bruce Franklin, the author of M.I.A. or Mythmaking in America. Bruce, I guess the best way to start this, and we could start it in so many different ways because it's really a fascinating subject and a scary one too, at least from my viewpoint. Maybe we could start by your describing this M.I.A. POW fantasy, and I underline that word fantasy because I'm sure there are many people who still believe that we have POWs out there in Vietnam somewhere hiding in hooches or held underground as in The Deer Hunter, you know, the movie and all that sort of thing. So kind of tell us a little bit about that fantasy.
Well, the last survey that I've seen shows that about 70% of the American people believe that there are still American prisoners of war being held in Indochina. Here we are 19 years after the war. In fact, there has yet to be a shred of verifiable evidence or even credible evidence that any American prisoners were withheld against their will by any of the governments of Indochina after the war. But it's something that is not only believed by people and believed very passionately by many people, but it's also been the basis of our foreign policy ever since the official end of the war in January 1973, that for 19 years our government has been considering Vietnam to be still an enemy nation, to be conducting hostilities against it, economic and political hostilities, on the basis of the assumption that there are still live POWs there. And beyond that, it is something which approaches being a national religion. The only flag other than the Star Spangled Banner ever to fly over the White House is the POW MIA flag. It is the only flag ever to be displayed in the Capitol building, in the rotunda of the Capitol, and it's there on permanent exhibit today. It is state law in all 50 states that that flag must be displayed. Most states require that it be displayed on municipal buildings and so on. And so it has a very great power within our culture and within our psychology as a people.
Now, all the figures that we have seen or I've heard about, figures of men missing in action, prisoners of war. Where did these figures come from? What are exactly these figures?
Well, as of today, there are 2,266 still unaccounted for from the Indochina War. And I want to stress the terms here, that's unaccounted for. That compares with, say, the Korean War. There are 8,100 unaccounted for still from the Korean War. And from World War II, we still have 78,750 unaccounted for. So by measuring against other wars, this is an extremely small number. It's an astonishingly small number. Now, I mean, I think we have to recognize that if one of those were your loved one, the number one would be a very large number. But I mean, looking at as this, as the results of the longest war in American history fought in tropical jungles, mountainous terrain, it is really astonishing that we have only 2,266 unaccounted for. Now, of that total, almost half were never MIA, that is, missing in action. 1,101 were men known to have been killed, but in circumstances where their body could not be recovered. That's the only thing that's unaccounted for, is their body. The official designation is KIA/BNR, killed in action, body not recovered. So the total MIA is 1,165, of whom all, no doubt, are dead.
Mm-hmm. So therefore, there's really no such thing as an MIA anymore. In your book, I recall reading where it said about a plane, and this was an American plane, going down. It was witnessed by another plane. And the pilot said that when he would make out his report, there was no point in him saying that the guy was dead. He would just say he just went down, which I think would throw him immediately into the MIA category. And his reasons for that, I thought, were fairly understandable. He says no sense in having the family of this flyer suffer unduly by knowing that he was dead, would cut off the pay. Mm-hmm. Of the flyer and so forth. What do you think about that sort of thing? I can understand that kind of a thing happening, but again, it's changing the rules of the game somewhat.
Right. It is up to the squadron commander to decide whether somebody is to be categorized as MIA, missing in action, or KIA, killed in action. And I think people have to understand the actual personal involvement in a situation like this. 81% of the missing were airmen. And the relationship between the squadron commander and the other people who are flying in that squadron is not like the relationship between the commanding officers and, say, men in the field. I flew myself in the Strategic Air Command. Mm-hmm. The squadron commander is friends and social associates of the other men in his squadron. His wife is a friend and social associate of the other wives. So for the squadron commander, very often was reluctant to tell the wife of a friend of his wife that her husband was dead, and maybe he wanted the benefits to continue. However, there's also a gender issue involved here because these were men making the decision, and in many cases they weren't considering the actual consequences for the wives, who in many cases were fairly young women with a life they could lead. And this led to some very ugly scenes in the years 1974, 1976, when a number of wives in this situation actually had to go to court to have their husbands declared dead because they wanted to get on and lead some other life. And in some cases, parents would then attack the wife and say things like, well, it's easier to get a new husband than it is to get a new son. So there were very grave psychological consequences, and still are, because, of course, when one loses a loved one, in order to heal, we human beings have to go through and complete a process of grieving and come to some kind of closure. And so the people who have been keeping this issue alive have been preventing many of the family members from completing this necessary human process. The wounds just keep on reopening.
Mm-hmm. Tell us about those conclusions that were arrived at by, I think it was Representative Montgomery of Mississippi. What were those conclusions exactly?
Yeah, well, this is extremely interesting because I, as part of the research for the book, I went back and went through all the research that had been done by people on all different sides of the issue. Sonny Montgomery was a conservative congressman from Mississippi who, in the years right after the war, was the most ardent believer that there were live prisoners of war in Indochina. And finally, he convinced the House of Representatives to create a select committee, make him the chair, and conduct investigations. They did an excellent job. They worked for 15 months. There are 5 volumes of hearings, which are still available in government depository libraries. They had access to all the top secret files. The trails were a lot warmer then than they are now. They went to Southeast Asia. And their conclusions were, one, there are no live prisoners of war, just no evidence for that. That there may have been as many as 14 cases of men who could have been captured and who were not adequately accounted for. And of those, 4 hypothetically might still be alive, and 1 was definitely alive, and that was Robert Garwood. They didn't identify him by name, but they gave all the particulars, so it was clear that this is Garwood. And that is the only one who ever has turned out to be alive. So the work of that committee was very much substantiated by this. Another conclusion that they had was that there was no way that you could ever get a complete accounting for the missing in a war. There never had been a complete accounting for the missing from any war. Montgomery himself said, "I had wanted to believe, and so I did, but when I faced the evidence, I had to recognize there just wasn't any evidence that there were any prisoners."
Yeah.
Another very interesting aspect of the Montgomery Commission investigation was they had heard that there was some kind of secret document that President Nixon had sent to Hanoi promising aid in rebuilding the country after the war. And so they had representatives from the State Department come to the committee and testify. These representatives swore up and down no such document existed. When the Montgomery Committee went to Hanoi, members of the Hanoi government gave them a copy of this document. I actually reproduce it as an appendix in the book. And in this document, Nixon promised several billion dollars of aid in rebuilding the country. Curiously, the POW activists have used that as a way of convincing themselves that the Vietnamese have a motive for holding prisoners. I fail to understand how their logic works, since the idea is that they're holding the prisoners as bargaining chips. Mm-hmm. But there's no way you can bargain with chips you swear you don't hold. The way this issue actually works is that it provided a way for the Nixon administration to wriggle out of the pledge that they had made of these billions of dollars for rebuilding the country after the war, because then they put out the idea, well, maybe there are live prisoners there, you haven't given an adequate accounting, and so it's not really rational and justifiable that we should be paying money when you may be holding some of our prisoners.
Yeah, yeah. H. Ross Perot has been in the news of late, and in a very, strange way, yeah, in that the polls have shown that he is leading Bush and Clinton and just about everyone else. I guess one of the big shocks in your book is the fact that Perot was involved in this, and I want to ask you about that, but first we'll pause for a message, and we'll return with our guest H. Bruce Franklin right after this. Back with our guest, H. Bruce Franklin, and we're talking about, well, I can't think of a better term for it than the hoax, the elaborate hoax of the POWs and the MIAs from Vietnam. I mentioned before we cut away, Bruce, about H. Ross Perot and having a part in this. Tell us about that.
Well, probably nobody has played a more important role in concocting the whole POW issue than H. Ross Perot. And to understand his role, it's a fascinating story, and it's one that really surprised me when I was doing the research for this, exactly how this worked. We've got to go back to 1968. The American people were sick to death of the Vietnam War, and they elected a peace candidate who promised that he had a secret plan to end the war as soon as he was inaugurated. That was Richard Nixon. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, Richard Nixon had no intention of ending the war. He had been one of the main designers of the war back in the 1954-61 period, and he intended to keep this war going until his original objectives could be met. But how is he going to do that? This is where the POW issue emerges. First part of the strategy was to deadlock the negotiations that were going on in Paris by demanding that Hanoi and the southern insurgents release all American prisoners of war as a precondition to our discussing the terms for the end of the war, which is ridiculous. That's what warring nations don't do that. They agree on the terms of the end of the war, and then they exchange their prisoners. Then what he needed was somehow to convince the American people that Hanoi not doing this meant that they were holding our men as, these were the key terms, hostages, ransom, and bargaining chips. Enter H. Ross Perot in the spring of 69. The POW issue was constructed first by Nixon as soon as he took office in January. In March through May, he announced the Go Public campaign. In June, brought Perot in to plan strategy with Congress and how to conduct a media blitz on the POW issue and convince the American people that, in fact, Hanoi was holding our men as hostages, ransom, and bargaining chips. And they worked this out brilliantly. It was a really very slick job. One of the things they did was to plan a newspaper advertisement. This was done jointly by Perot and Nixon aides, to be run the very day that Nixon would sign a bill, which in fact was passed unanimously by the House and Senate in early November, demanding that Hanoi release all the prisoners now. And the ad ran on November 9th, the day Nixon signed the bill. It was headlined, "The Majority Speaks, Release the Prisoners Now." And then there was a picture of two little children praying, "Please, Daddy, come home safe, sound, and soon." And then you had little things to tear off to sign and send to Hanoi to demand that they release our prisoners now. Senator Robert Dole got Democratic Representative Clement Zablocki to turn a subcommittee into a forum for Perot to give marching orders to Congress and to the media on staging this big publicity blitz. This was in the spring of 1970, which he did. One of the things that he had Congress do was to set up an exhibit in the rotunda of the Capitol, two American prisoners of war surrounded by giant cockroaches and rats. And Chairman Zablocki asked him to come up and tell radio, TV, newspaper people how they should play this campaign, which they obediently did. The next step was Perot organized a joint session of the House and Senate. I mean, the idea of this guy being a Washington outsider is really ludicrous when you watch how he was pulling all these strings for Nixon behind the scenes. And so they had this joint session, which was addressed by Borman, who had resigned from the Apollo program in order to work for Perot, first as head of one of Perot's foundations, then as a vice president for EDS, Perot's company. These connections get very complex. Meanwhile, of course, the Nixon administration was doing all kinds of things about interceding with Perot with various agencies so he could get contracts and getting the IRS off his back so he could amass the fortune, which everybody thinks is a sign of his great success. It's a great story. Perot did some things personally as part of the campaign. One thing he did was he chartered a jet, loaded it up with reporters and Christmas presents for the POWs, and flew to Hanoi, knowing, of course, that Vietnam wasn't going to let him in the middle of a war, landed in Laos, went with a bullhorn to the Vietnamese embassy and staged a big media event for all the reporters.
My question has to be, Bruce, with this type of knowledge, and I would assume that many people are aware of Perot's involvement in this hoax, as we call it, why are they pushing him to be the number one man to unseat Bush and to obliterate Clinton and all the rest?
Well, of course, most people don't think it's a hoax. Mm-hmm. I mean, most people, when they think of Perot's role in this, I mean, this is, after all, his one claim to fame as a public-spirited figure, except for later the Iran hostage situation where a couple of his employees were involved. But it's really the Vietnam POW thing which was the horse that he rode to fame as, as a public figure. I think if people realized that this whole thing was in fact a Nixon-Perot concoction originally, they might have a very different idea. But in fact, this is the first time in this book that the American people have heard the history of how this whole issue was invented, why, who did it, what the motives were, and how it's operated in American culture.
All the more reason why people should read this book to become aware of what really happened and what's really going on. I must be terribly naive, though, to think or to feel that the government of the United States would actually manipulate the fears and the feelings of parents who have, and wives, let's say, who have husbands and children in this conflict, and to manipulate them in order to carry out four more years of war, which is what Nixon did. I know it's so,
But I still find it hard to swallow.
Well, when you take a step back, you see that we have been conducting hostilities against Vietnam without interruption since 1946. And we've had all kinds of pretexts, all kinds of ways to manipulate the American people, to get us into the war in the first place, to keep us in that war, to keep the war going in various forms ever since. You know, one of the surprising things about this issue is comes from debates that I've had with people on the other side, you know, leading activists on the POW MIA issue who believe thoroughly that there are POWs there, they say. And that is, we have some large areas of agreement. And one is that, and I think that here it's general agreement among the American people. That is, American people now are aware of the fact that our government does lie to us systematically and in order to manipulate us to support policy. I mean, it doesn't shock anybody anymore. Everyone just nods and agrees. Then the issue between my understanding of the reality here and the people on the other side who are the activists is simply, how is the government lying? How is the government manipulating us? Because one thing becomes very clear as soon as you start doing research into this area, and that is that if there were any live POWs in Indochina, or if there are, there is no way that our government could not know that they exist. We have satellite surveillance, aerial surveillance, a very elaborate intelligence infrastructure on the ground, and we have interrogated tens of thousands of refugees, including defectives from high-level military intelligence services in all of these countries. So one way or the other, the government has to know either there are live POWs or there aren't live POWs. But what has been the government position? Consistent ambiguity. The government position is, well, maybe they're live POWs, maybe they're not. We're doing our best to find them. And meanwhile, we're going to base foreign policy on the assumption that there are live POWs. So the POW believers faced with this come to the conclusion there must be an elaborate conspiracy and cover-up in the government, because they must know that their POWs are there and are covering up. I look at all the evidence that they're producing, see that it's all, at best, misinformed and very often just plain bogus.
Yeah.
And come to the conclusion that what the government is doing is just keeping this thing alive, but they don't want it in the form of the belief that, yes, there are definitely live POWs there, because then they'd have to do something about
sure.
it. So the issue has turned into a kind of Frankenstein's monster for the government.
Mm-hmm. And the irony, too, to me anyway, is that the other side, who didn't believe that there are POWs, MIAs, they saying, well, the government's lying to us. So you have both sides, who, you know, really have not much in common, saying that the government is lying. So everybody's saying that that's what it is. Just about run out of time here, Bruce, on this particular segment. We're going to have Bruce Franklin back again with us later on this week, and we're going to talk about the Rambo films and the Chuck Norris films and how that played a great part in continuing this elaborate hoax. I'm Joe Hunter. Good morning. Joe Hunter. This is Prespective, and this is part two of a program which we started last Monday, having to do with MIA or myth-making in America. And it has to do with the POWs and the MIAs, an elaborate hoax on the part of the government that kept the war going for four more years. Our guest, the author of
M.I.A. or Mythmaking in America, and also the John Cotton Dana Professor of English and American Studies at Rutgers University, H. Bruce Franklin. And we'll talk with Mr. Franklin right after this message. Our guest, H. Bruce Franklin. Bruce, for the benefit of those viewers who weren't with us for the last time, the last segment when you were on, could you kind of reprise the part where how Nixon used this hoax to elongate the war for four more years?
Well, basically, Nixon had a big problem when he was inaugurated in January 1969 because he'd run as a peace candidate promising immediate end to the war. What he did was to construct the POW issue to keep the war going for four more years. He used it to deadlock the negotiations in Paris by demanding that Hanoi release all the prisoners of war as a precondition to our agreeing to discuss the terms of for the end of the war. And on a domestic front, convinced tens and tens of millions of Americans that somehow this amounted to Hanoi holding our men as hostages, ransom, and bargaining chips. Those were the key terms. Mm-hmm. And the major person he called upon to do the media blitz necessary to sell this to the American people and to get Congress in line to go along was H. Russ Perot, who did a brilliant job for Nixon and was amply rewarded for his efforts.
I guess many of the viewers are probably thinking to themselves, was Nixon really this Machiavellian? I mean, was he that smart to come up with something like that that could just completely snow the American public the way it did?
Nixon was I guess he still is, very smart, extremely ingenious. I mean, for instance, imagine him selling himself as a peace candidate in 1968 when he had been one of the main architects of the war in the first place.
Yeah, yeah.
Which everybody forgot or didn't know.
Could you describe the role of the National League of Families and the other groups in disseminating this myth?
Well, the National League of Families was drawn together from various somewhat informal organization of wives of prisoners, mainly prisoners, then later some, including some of the missing. And when the Nixon administration looked around for some group that could provide support that would really trigger very strong emotional responses from the American people, they seized upon these existing organizations and helped them form into one called the National League of Families of Prisoners and Missing in Southeast Asia. Sybil Stockdale was the main leader of this, and she worked very closely with Senator Robert Dole and with H. Ross Perot in doing publicity and so forth to help build the organization. And the organization at first was a very staunch advocate of Nixon policies, but that started coming apart. I mean, the organization was formed in 1970. By the end of 1971, there were really two factions emerging in the National League, one continuing to support Nixon, the other being an anti-war faction. And that's a very interesting story, which I go into in some detail in the book. With the conclusion of the war, of course, membership in the National League dropped very, very rapidly, because certainly the wives of the prisoners who came back now had very little motive to be in the organization. And the great majority of the families of the missing reconciled themselves to the fact that their loved one was dead. Well, the organization continued as a kind of oppositional force, and then in 1974, there was a takeover of the organization. This was the only meeting held outside of Washington. It was held in Omaha. Air Force planes flew people there. And essentially, a group of right-wing ideologues took over that organization. And it then continued pushing the POW issue during the period from 74 until the inauguration of Reagan in 81. Reagan was a major, major figure in this. Reagan had been involved in the POW issue from way back, in fact, all the way back to the time when he had been an actual prisoner of war himself as the hero of the 1954 Korean War movie, POW. And by Early 83, this was very, very important to the Reagan administration. And this is where we start getting the real Hollywood tie-in. January 83, Reagan announced at a meeting of the National League of Families that the POW-MIA issue had become, quote, the highest national priority, unquote.
I remember from your book, there was a mention of Reagan saying, I think he'd seen Rambo. Mm-hmm. And he said, I now know what to do next time at this something like this. Right. He also said something about he would go start World War III, didn't he?
Yeah. Well, the story here involves another fascinating figure, is Bo Greitz, who was a highly decorated Special Forces colonel during the Vietnam War, and who became convinced that there were a lot of POWs, started doing a lot of publicity around this in 1980, 1981. And during that period was organizing to conduct raids into Laos. He went and saw Perot. They give very contradictory accounts of the meeting and what happened. But Greitz himself was very influenced by Hollywood visions of things. And for example, when he was asked why he was the one, he said that destiny had chosen him because the only other two men of action who could carry out something like this were both dead, Teddy Roosevelt and John Wayne. John Wayne, of course, who never fought in anything except movies. So when Greitz went into Laos in 82, by this time he and many other POW activists had the idea that although the president believed in their cause, he was surrounded by all these liberal pinko bureaucrats from the CIA who wouldn't let him know the truth, what they call them, the gatekeepers. So Greitz decided that what he needed was some means of communication directly to Reagan. So he arranged to have communication directly to Clint Eastwood, who was Reagan's old friend, at his ranch at Shasta, California. And then Eastwood was supposed to get in touch with Reagan at his ranch in Santa Barbara. There are various versions of what actually happened, but when the raiders came back from Laos, after their first raid in late November 82, they had a telegram from a team member who said that Clint and I talked to the president, this is Reagan, and the president said, if you find one POW, I will start World War III to get them out, unquote.
Yeah, yeah, that was the one. Mm. Well, now, as a result of that, Greitz and the rest of this, seeing that they had a Hollywood vision of the war, was this the result of movies like Uncommon Valor with Hackman and Rambo with Sly Stallone and the Chuck Norris films Missing in Action 1 and 2 and so forth?
Well, the first of the POW rescue movies was Uncommon Valor, starring Gene Hackman, modeled largely on Greitz himself. This came out in December 83. There was another role in that movie which was modeled on Perot. Remember that there's a Texas multimillionaire who provides the support for the Hackman figure in the movie. And that was followed by Missing in Action 1 with Chuck Norris. Later came Missing in Action 2, which was actually a prequel. And then in 85 came Rambo First Blood Part 2 with Sylvester Stallone and a whole host of other ones. David Carradine and POW The Escape. And I don't know if I've seen them all. I've seen a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
And also dozens and dozens of novels. POW, MIA Hunter, and so on.
Well, certainly that this must have been what the public wanted, because I understand those movies were box office smashes, and especially the Rambo films. I mean, there were all kinds of toys, Rambo toys, Rambo dolls, and so forth.
Well, on one level, I think it's easy to understand. There was a very famous quotation, actually, from a reporter interviewed somebody coming out of Uncommon Valor, which was a smash hit, big surprise, because you know, it's a crummy movie.
Mm-hmm.
And the critics all thought, yeah, the routine action here, who's going to see this? And it was a smash hit of the Christmas season of 83. And so somebody being interviewed coming out, and a reporter said, well, you know, why did you really like this movie? He said, we get to win this time.
Yeah.
And that leads to Rambo's famous line, when Troutman gives him his mission at the beginning of the movie, he says, sir, do we get to win this time?
Yeah.
And so the movies were a way of projecting us as the good guys and as the winners. So these heroes could go in and slaughter dozens or scores or hundreds of Vietnamese with ease, rescue the prisoners, and redeem the honor of the nation.
Well, really, this was another way of rewriting history, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Favor us.
Oh, I guess the word we really should be using now is re-imaging history.
Yeah, re-imaging, that's the term.
And probably re-imaging is a whole lot more powerful than rewriting.
Yeah, yeah. Do you feel that the people today have really, well, swallowed the idea that they were taken insofar as the hoax was concerned?
Well, I'm getting a reading on this. It's a little hard for me to say with certainty, but I've been doing a lot of call-in shows for the last few months, actually, because the book was excerpted as the cover story for the December Atlantic Monthly, and it started back then. And at first, the call-in shows were dominated by people arguing, yes, there are live POWs, what about this, what about that, and presenting what they believe to be true facts and evidence and so forth, a lot of which I've exposed and some of which other people have exposed. The last, I would say, 6 weeks on call-in shows, I've been surprised because there's been very, very little opposition. And a lot of people are calling in to voice their support and saying that they had suspected this all along. And I've even gotten correspondence now from some people who were POW activists who realized that they were had on this issue. And that they've been manipulated in a way exactly the opposite from the way they thought they were being manipulated.
Yeah. My own paranoia makes me have to ask you, has anybody tried to get you in any kind of way?
No. I was warned when I was working on this book, your life may be in danger and so forth, and I don't know if I should be, I'm not inviting them, but I haven't had any death threats. And in fact, the people who have argued either on call-in shows or writing me letters, who have been angry in a fairly reasonable way. I mean, they believe that certain facts are true. I believe they're not, and we have an argument.
Sure.
And in fact, one of the things that seems to emerge is that there are a lot of people who are on the opposite side of this issue who, because I'm seriously concerned about it, see me as somebody who has something in common with them, that the people that they have the most anger against are people who just don't care one way or the other.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll pause for a message and return with our guest, H. Bruce Franklin, right after this. We're talking about the book, M.I.A., Mythmaking in America, by our guest, H. Bruce Franklin. And I want to go back to the Hollywood scene once more, Bruce. The Deer Hunter, that was a famous film about this. Now, how did you see this as contributing to the, what was your term, re-imaging of the war?
Well, what the Deer Hunter did was very, very skillfully and consciously take central images that the American people had seen in the Vietnam War and reversed them. For example, the most famous image, perhaps of all, which was that of the head of the Saigon National Police Force executing a Viet Cong prisoner right on television. People saw this in their living rooms, and there was a still photo sequence of it. That becomes the central metaphor for the deer hunter, even down to the revolver, even down to the details. There's one series of frames in which you actually see blood spurting out of the temple of one of the Americans who's being killed by the evil North Vietnamese. Exactly the same image that we saw, but reversed, because instead of our side doing it to one of our prisoners, their side is doing it to one of us held as a prisoner.
Yeah.
The opening sequence in Vietnam, we see a woman and child, so several women and children in an underground shelter, and a uniformed soldier opens that up and throws a grenade down. And that's an image that we had seen, but it was an American soldier. Here it's a North Vietnamese soldier. And then he kills a woman and children in a scene that comes right out of the My Lai photographs. Mm. And then he's killed by a lone guerrilla. The lone guerrilla is not a Viet Cong, it's Robert De Niro, a special forces hero, and so on. And or there's another one, there's a sequence in which we see two American prisoners trying to escape falling off a helicopter. That's exactly modeled on a famous telephoto sequence of Viet Cong prisoners being pushed out of an American helicopter to make the next one talk. Mm-hmm. What really surprised me, there's a whole sequence in that movie where De Niro and Christopher Walken are shot in silhouette. And I understand, why are they in silhouette? You know, why is the lighting like this? And there's this single strand of barbed wire. Why is the barbed wire there? They're supposed to be in this bamboo cage. How does the barbed wire get there? And I went through it real slow on video. And lo and behold, what did I see but the image from the POW MIA flag? So they actually have subliminals going on in that movie.
Really?
But the movie, remember, was the... got the Oscar for the best movie of 78. The New York Film Critics Circle gave it their award for the best movie of the year. And the movie represented a turning point because it was here that prisoners of war became the symbol of disgraced, dishonored, or emasculated American manhood.
Mm-hmm. This scene also in the Deer Hunter where they play Russian roulette.
Right.
Now, how is that?
You know, that whole series of scenes is the one that's those are the ones that are modeled exactly on the picture of the South Vietnamese police chief killing the NLF prisoner with a revolver to the temple. Except what they do is they set it up so that the American holding a revolver to his own head, his elbow is cut off. In the frame, so you just see an arm with a revolver to match up to the other sequence. Later movies go even closer to the original sequence. For instance, POW, The Escape, has it exactly matched.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's a North Vietnamese commander actually holding a revolver to the head of an American prisoner and killing him.
There was also in your book about a KGB general. Mm-hmm. Kalugin, I think is
Oleg name. Kalugin.
Yeah, what was his part in this?
Well, this is part of the story really that's happened since April 91 when the Bush administration announced that they had a roadmap for normalizing relations with Vietnam. We've had one story after another, all the phony pictures and so forth, and the Kalugin thing was part of it. People don't realize a lot of stuff about Kalugin. One, he was kicked out of the KGB in 1990, stripped of his rank and medals for spreading false stories to the West. This had nothing to do with POWs originally, and trying to enrich himself by doing this. He started telling stories about Americans who were brought back to Russia. But the source that he cited for this, he didn't say that he knew about this directly. He said that he'd gotten this from another KGB agent named Oleg Necheporenko. When Necheporenko was asked, and later actually Necheporenko testified, he said it simply wasn't true.
Mm-hmm.
And that he had interrogated one American prisoner before the end of the war, none afterwards. And eventually, Kalugin was forced to publish what amounts to a retraction as a letter to the New York Times. I believe it was January 25th of this year.
Mm-hmm. I guess, Bruce, another thing that I've been wondering about since I read your book is why hasn't this been published before by someone else? I mean, this has been around for a long time, and I'm sure it was known for a long time. Of course, I know you've been working on Vietnam research for close to a quarter of a century.
Yeah.
But it seems to me somebody else might have picked up on this.
Well, this is such a strange issue. I don't really have good secure handles on this question because there have been so many puzzling things about it. I had expected when I was doing research for this that I would go out there and find that there was lots of stuff written by the people. It's a really major issue for American society, American history. And yet, there was no real academic work. I mean, no serious scholarship on this issue. And I think that one reason is that in the academy, I mean, in the world of scholarship, I mean, people have been basically taking a three monkeys approach to this issue. They don't want to recognize that it's even there, and it's and part of that is explained by the fact, if I talk to people, colleagues in the university, I will run into a number of people who say, well, I don't know anybody who believes that they're alive POWs. On the other hand, if you go talk to, you know, average American, whatever that means, you know, just an ordinary working person, I have had many conversations with people who say, I don't know anyone who doesn't believe they're alive POW. So there is this real division in the society on this issue, which I think accounts for the fact that there hasn't been that serious work.
Yeah.
Secondly, people have been really scared of it. I mean, I mentioned before that I was warned. This is very dangerous. People say, you're very brave for writing about this. And I say, oh, I hadn't thought about that. I didn't realize being brave. You know, maybe I wouldn't have done it. But so there is that element. And then the curious thing, when I went out and read the literature of true belief, all the books and pamphlets and newsletters and so forth, that stuff's overwhelmingly convincing. You read that stuff, you're totally convincing if you don't know too much about the real history of the Vietnam War and if you don't know too much about adequate methods of research and verifiable documentation.
Yeah. We've got maybe about a minute and a half left. How can all of this now be debunked and healing occur? And everybody will feel, well, all right, we know the truth, and we'll go on from there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that as people become acquainted with the actual history of the issue, you know, how it was concocted, who did it, and why, then people can understand how the whole POW MIA myth stands between us and a confrontation with reality. We have to confront the reality of the war and of the aftermath of the war if we're going to become well, if we're going to heal.
Even if people who have relatives out there and have been holding on for the past 20 years or so, with the hope that, yeah, maybe they're still alive, they'll have to come to the conclusion now that that's not so, that they're not. That's asking a lot from them, too.
Well, I think that most of all, they're the ones who end up healing from this. I got a very interesting letter from a psychiatrist in Atlanta who's been treating MIA families, and he had three families read my work, and they expressed profound gratitude because they did find it very helpful in healing.
And they accepted it then, huh?
Oh, yes. And I think many family members, and I understand this, I think I would feel the same way if I were in their position, feel that they would be betraying their loved one if they gave up hope, if there was any basis for hope.
But
when they realize that there really isn't any basis for hope, that they've been manipulated, then it's possible for them to go ahead and complete that process of grieving and come to closure and heal.
Lives. Right. Okay. My guest has been H. Bruce Franklin, the author of MIA, Mythmaking in America. I'm Joe Hunter. Good morning.